brings us once again to the urgent realization of just how much there is still left to own. Item 6 on the agenda, the meaning of life. Now, Harry, you've had some thoughts on this.
That's right, yeah, I've had a team working on this over the past few weeks, and what we've come up with can be reduced to two fundamental concepts. One, people are not wearing enough hats. Two, matter is energy. In the universe, there are many energy fields which we cannot normally perceive. Some energies have a spiritual source which act upon a person's soul. However, this soul does not exist ab initio, as Orthodox Christianity teaches. It has to be brought into existence by a process of guided self-observation. However, this is rarely achieved owing to man's unique ability to be distracted from spiritual matters by everyday trivia.
It really is. I think your mic's playing up again. This is Tuesday, 24th February 2014. You're listening to the Unpenned Show. My name is Andy.
And my name is Paul. Thank God for that. Started off with a rip-roaring start and the microphone wasn't switched on properly.
Gremlins.
Okay, we had a week off last week, but we're back this week. And the opening, the sequence, title sequence or whatever was... The Meaning of Life by Monty Python. Mm-hmm. I've watched it twice now. And
1983, was
yes,
it?
Yes, it was, 83. I've watched it twice now. And do you know, there's a satisfaction that I feel about it. Because, and you should feel the same as well.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, we're going back some time ago now. And we decoded this as Fish and Ships. Mm-hmm. And you watch that, and there's no... doubt about
it. Confirms it, doesn't it?
It absolutely does. Yeah. The discovery of the soul that some people don't think exists, and scientists, because dismiss. They cannot prove it, no. Say it cannot possibly be so. But for those few who listen to us, maybe you know, like I know, and maybe you agree with what I'm saying, there is something else, isn't there? There's something inside that makes you more than. Mm. And it is that more than little feeling. It isn't a superiority. It's just you know. You actually know that there's something more to life.
Yeah.
Many people, and even people who think they've discovered what is the alternative truth, are still busy gossiping and reading the news. And we have said many times, that is not possibly going to wake you up. It's going to piss you off and make you mad. Yeah. And it's going to actually make you tell people what to do. Mm. Imagine that you are listening to you. How would you accept what you were saying to you? Mm. It doesn't work out, does it?
No.
Because the reason that we're in this mess is the lies that we tell to ourselves. Because we live in one great big fairy tale. Mm-hmm. Wrapped up in one bloody great big lie.
Yeah.
That this is the way we have to live. Now, you and I know that we didn't take any part in constructing the world that we live in.
No.
We actually just got to live in it.
Yeah.
And we got to support it. And by supporting it, we give it our energy. Mm-hmm. And that's how the lights stay switched on.
Yeah.
Well, that's the way it is. Mm. It's the way that we have to accept exists before we came, and we'll be here after we've been.
Mm-hmm.
If you really want to actually be something while you're here, then the memories are based on what you do, what you are, how you act. Now, I know that being kind and generous and patient pays massive dividends. But not many people can do that, because we're busy telling people how to live their lives.
Mm, yeah.
We say that we have something you need to know, and I'm going to tell you what it is. And then we bluff and bluster, make a right mess of it, and tell people you shouldn't watch TV, you shouldn't read the newspapers, you shouldn't believe anything that people say, you should listen to me, because I have the truth. If that doesn't sound like cult,
mm-hmm.
then what does?
Yeah.
And you're doing it.
Mm.
You're asking people to make their lives less fun, less interesting, because you say so. It doesn't work.
No.
Of course it doesn't work.
But it fits with the narrative in, I wrote down, religion and confirmation. And that's all we ask for all the time is, can you confirm that? It's confirmation. The truth is confirmation. Mm-hmm. And that's what you went to in the, and you got it in the pulpit. But it was their version.
Pulped it.
You weren't allowed to think for yourself.
It all up. Yeah.
Yeah. And just as we've got this democracy now, or so-called democracy,
which just transcribes to mob rule.
Mob rule. We still don't have any. We're allowed to vote, yes, but it doesn't have any effect on what happens, and we're asking it for that confirmation all the time. And it never comes, and that's because, how the everlasting saviour...
But we're playing the part of children.
On. Yeah.
We're playing the part of children.
Exactly.
With the gossiping and the news and the chasing the girls or chasing the boys. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
We're playing the part of children. We really don't want to grow up.
No.
Because growing up, this is just my experience, you no longer feel the need to argue or correct people who are wrong. You just don't feel the need at all. Because they are so convinced they're right. Let them be so.
Mm.
You never once claim you have the truth. Because I don't think it's available. It isn't available. The truth, about 3 or 4 years ago, I said, you know, the only truth, and everyone accepts it, is that when the sun comes up, we'll live.
Mm.
And the whole world's religions are based on that fact.
They are. East to west.
The only truth is that if the sun comes up, we will live for another day.
Yeah. The Ark of the Covenant.
I mean, you can say death and taxes and try and make me, you know, you can cliche with death and taxes. Okay, I'm okay with that.
Yeah.
But the only truth we can share is if that big yellow ball turns up, we're okay for another day. You know, and in the confusion and chaos of the world we live in, take that all away and realise that it wasn't that hard to understand why they were pretty happy when the yellow ball turned up every morning.
Mm. Yeah. What exasperates me is once you've got this, and you realised you've been had at the snake oil salesman's,
Mr. Ism.
Yes.
Any ism you like.
Any ism.
Sign here. Sign here, I'll guarantee you better wages, shorter hours, bigger families, lower prices. Yeah. You sign here and I'll be your friend.
And you sit back and you get to our town life, you say, now what?
Yeah.
Now what? What
we're here, aren't we?
We do.
And we're actually here.
And we've tried. We've tried. I think the only opportunity we've got, and we've talked about it, is if your MP, you actually know them. And we've got an opportunity, haven't we, in May, to vote for somebody who we know.
Yep.
And we'll probably be voting for that person because we know them.
Yes.
And not what colour they are, what colour banner they have.
Because we have access to them. There it is. There it is.
Yes.
We have access to them.
Mm-hmm. And we're not having to pay £5,000
Do we know what Jack Straw... exactly. £5,000 a day, my lecturer's fee. So do you see that what the lives that we live, even at this lower level, is just a mirror of every life above you. And isn't that what's taught us what we know? Isn't that how we still sit here and sort of say, for many people who listen, it's maybe only 5 or 10 minutes that you get out of this. That's okay, it doesn't matter. Because we do this so we can listen back to us. This is actually our way of making ourselves do this. But we're maybe being a little bit selfish, aren't we, really? We actually sit here and talk with the mics and the headphones, and we do it in such a way that it makes us focus and concentrate. Whereas if we weren't, we wouldn't.
No. No. Through the week, it keeps your mind more active.
And you say, I must mention that on Tuesday.
Yes.
I must mention that on Tuesday.
And there's tons of stuff we write down and we forget to mention.
Not a bloody jot of it, do we?
No.
But the thing is, if this is any use to anybody, I suspect I would probably say, for the people who are just discovering that the world isn't quite like you thought it was, and you're trying to unlearn what you know, keep going, because it is worth doing.
It is.
There is a downside to this, and that is that you have an awful lot less friends.
Yes.
But I say that you've got an awful lot less friends, but the realisation of this journey is that they weren't really your friends
anyway.
They
weren't, no.
They were actually just your friends while you were doing what they wanted.
Yeah.
It's not really very pretty what you discover.
No.
But it is very useful.
Yeah.
Because everything is doing what you're doing. But you have to admit to you first that you're doing this. You have to admit to you your thought process, your methods of how you try and achieve what you want to do in life. You have to weigh up the pros and cons.
Yeah.
You have to decide who to trade with, who to talk to, and who to exchange things with. And you have to say to yourself, there are times when I'm going to have to perhaps skirt around the truth. Because if everyone knew what I was up to, then that would be a disadvantage in me getting there. That's the way you've been programmed your entire life.
Yeah.
We've been programmed to compete. You say, why do MPs lie? Why do MPs feel the need to lie? Exactly the same reason you do. Because if you told everybody what you were really doing and what you were really thinking, you wouldn't be as popular as you are now.
No.
So, the information you release is based on your popularity score. This is a world full of popularity contests. That's what it is.
Yeah.
How many friends you got on Facebook? How many friends you got on Twitter? It's all about how popular you want to be. Well, you sort of have to give up that way of thinking. You sort of have to say to yourself, am I really acting to be popular? And how much of it is really me? This is the tricky bit of the inside and outside. Now, when you look at other people, you say, oh, she's beautiful on the outside, but she's not so pretty on the inside. So, most people accept that there are at least two versions of one person individual. Well, the language backs that up, internally divided into two. The trick is, can you get it down to one? The trick is, can you be the same person all day, regardless of who you meet? Well, the answer for most people is no. Because at some point, you have to say yes, sir, no, sir, three bags full, sir.
Yeah.
You can't be the black sheep. No, no, no. You have to say, ba, ba, yes, sir. You see? Because you're a slave. Now, you're a modern-day slave, and you get to actually pick where you live. And you actually shop for your own food, and you decorate your cage. But you're a slave. You're a slave to a debt-based money system that makes you go to work every day. And over the last lifetime, one lifetime, you've been invited to get yourselves personally into debt to buy the things you think you need to be happy. So you have. So now you have to go to work. You see, as we get lazier and lazier, then those that know how the world really works knew that they had to indebt you, so you bloody work harder. Because yes, it is a fictional money system, but without it, you will starve. So you go to work every day. to pay them for making this world for you.
Mm-hmm.
You actually want to get out of debt? Okay, spend 3 or 4 or 5 years on the get out of debt free sites that are available on the internet. When you've lost everything, your wife, your kids, your house, your car, and your job, don't tell me you knew what you were doing. Because you didn't. You just didn't want to pay your bills. Mm. When you sign your name, it is actually the most valuable thing you have. It is the only thing you have. And it is the ultimate and original mark of the beast that you are. That signature is confirmation that you are in the game. You exist. Now, when I first started the discovery of how this really works, I was led to believe that I could choose to be in or out. I can join that, but I can refuse this. It's a game of consent. I have to consent to this, but I can say no thank you to that. I wish that was true. It's not. You're either in or you're out.
Mm.
It's as simple as that. You're in if you need something. Doctor, dentist, police, fireman, job, house, mortgage, loan, marriage, you're in. If you don't want any of those things, you can be out. But you can't work for anybody. Not officially, anyway.
No.
Because as an employer, I am not allowed to pay you unless you have given me validation of who you are. In other words, I have to see who you are.
Mm.
I have to see your identity and be able to record it. And you'll be recorded as a name and address. Well, if you give me that, you're in. So what you're really saying with the lose the name game is, you're out. So how'd you live?
Mm.
You're gonna join the cows and eat grass? There is no out.
There isn't.
They're only dealing with being in. Defending yourself. Yeah. Stand up for yourself.
Mm.
Asking the right questions. Refusing to answer their questions unless they answer yours.
Yeah.
You want to lose an argument? Answer questions. You want to win an argument? Ask the darn things. But make sure you know what to ask. Make sure you know what to say.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you say, I am a freeman of the land. No, you're not. You're living on somebody else's money. I haven't taxed my car because I don't have to. Yes, you do. Because it's not insured if you don't tax it. Okay. So you're not insured. So you're going to pay out if you damage something. The reason why, let's be honest, the reason why I haven't paid your car tax is because you can't bloody afford it, can you? You've come on here, you're down on your luck, you've found a fortune teller that you like. Because the internet is a fortune teller if you choose to use it for this.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, it's just the best playground you've never been in before. The get out of debt free gang, I actually don't wish to be nasty to you, because they have been banging on for years about parking tickets, and mainstream news this week that private companies trying to make claims through parking tickets and charging whatever they feel like is now proven to be fraudulent. So well done.
Mm-hmm.
They have actually achieved something in studying the law in that way, because the fact that it's on mainstream TV means that you now can fight back. We've said before more than once, just garble a letter full of BS. And as long as it sounds a challenge to them, they will have two choices. They either have to get a real solicitor to actually work out what your challenge is, or just throw it in the bin. And the chances are, if you do it properly, they just throw it in the bin and say, we can't pay a real solicitor and still make money on this. Just throw it in the bin. That's what's been happening more often than not.
Mm.
So yeah, well done to the legal crowd, or the, you know, the actual get out of debt free crowd, because they have challenged parking successfully.
Yeah,
and I'm pretty sure that that loophole will be closed very shortly. So well done to you guys. I'm not saying it's worthless what you're doing. I'm saying that if you want to live in a world of hospital doctors, dentists, nurses, firemen, police, and those things that you're going to need at some point in your life, you're going to have to be in, You're going to have to deal with binning. You have to do what you have to do and get along with it.
Yeah.
There isn't such a thing as a free lunch. Not in the system, it isn't. There is at the moment, but it won't last forever. I mean, the free lunch is still here.
It is, you know, for the time being.
But it's getting harder.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to be asked to do something, because doing nothing for something is not fair.
No.
So even though I sound like a conservative, I'm not.
No.
I'm actually warning you, and I've warned you many times before, that if you don't do something, the system will find something for you to do.
Yeah.
I've said that many times, haven't I?
Mm-hmm.
Now, being self-employed is great if you have something that you can do. And I would advocate it for everybody. And that's what I said 2 weeks ago, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Find something that you can do and then be bloody good at it.
Yeah.
Do your own little simple paperwork accounts, claim for everything, and keep out the way.
Mm-hmm.
It sounds like you're giving up, but I'm not giving up at all. We have to fight from within the system.
Yeah.
Being outside the system makes us...
Mm.
doesn't matter at all then. Without any product in it, without us being something... It doesn't matter what we say. We can gossip and shout and bawl and scream. That doesn't matter.
Mm-hmm.
Those days have gone.
Yep.
We stopped doing that a long time ago.
Mm-hmm.
I travelled all the way to London to take part in a protest once, and I thought, what a waste of time that was.
Yeah.
Full of clueless people, full of banners.
All it did
banners and clueless people shouting the ball at the employers that they wanted a better deal.
And it took
good for them. Good for them. I mean, but the thing is, they didn't actually down tools.
No.
They didn't have a proper union. If you want a better deal... There are other ways of doing it than marching through the streets of London.
Mm.
You have to make yourself worth a better deal. You have to... My staff, okay, I can rank them by how important they are to me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm.
Now, in the old days, I would have never taught my staff anything, or as much as I know, about my business. Otherwise... What advantage would I have as the employer? But now, I don't mind. I'll teach them everything about the business.
Mm-hmm.
Everything I know about the business, I'll teach them. Because then I can actually let them run it.
Mm.
But that's not the way the world of work really works, is it?
No.
The hierarchy of the office block is the guy at the top knows the most and does the least. And the people at the bottom know the least and do the most.
Do the most, yeah. That's how it works, yeah.
So, in other words, this is a game of intelligence, isn't it?
Mm.
And it's always been a game of intelligence. I mean, look around at the world you live in. We always talk about the world we live in, right? Really attractive people aren't always very bright, are they?
No.
But on the other hand, the rather unattractive people, they already know that they're going to have to go through the... they have to supplement this problem with intelligence.
Mm-hmm.
So the weakest people, the ugliest people, become the most intelligent and thereby assume control of... The good-looking people.
Mm-hmm.
Well, have a look around. Isn't that the world we live in? I mean, don't we actually say, well, I never. Beauty and brains together. Or brawn and brains. Who'd have thought? Don't find that very often, do you? Well, that's why. Because those good-looking people, they already know that the world is going to be favourable to them. Whereas the not-so-good-looking people, they already know the world isn't going to be favourable to them. So they have to be intelligent and take control of the positions that are designed for them. So we end up with the weak.
Westminster.
Yeah. We end up with the weak controlling everybody else.
Yeah.
Well, at what point didn't we think that's how the world's been working for an awful long time?
A long time, yeah. Yeah.
You know, there's those that want to fight. Well, they join the forces.
Mm.
And when this, you know, when the numbers are a little bit nervous, as it were, for the system...
Mm.
We must have a war to call the ones that want to fight. So let's get rid of a few. You get rid of a few of yours, and we'll get rid of a few of ours, and that'll calm them all down again.
Yeah. Well, that with Rome and in Egypt, wasn't it? With Antony and Cleopatra. She was very. She was the queen of Egypt, but she was apparently, history tells us, very very good, attractive, good looking woman.
Uh huh. About 16 years old, wasn't she?
And
about
yeah,
16, 17.
They were always younger, weren't they? Then
yeah.
And they joined forces. There was the mighty Antony, and the used the beauty of Cleopatra, the joining of the two to get what they both wanted.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Well, it's all about Egypt. Again, a news item that we don't normally cover, but the activists of the 2011 Egyptian uprising are now being rounded up by the military that have taken control of Egypt. They've been rounded up. And those activists in 2011 that we all cheered on, they've been rounded up, and 180 were slaughtered in January. Just shot. Excused.
Right. Mm-hmm.
They don't worry about it, they just shoot them. Now, if ISIS behead a journalist,
yes,
we have to go and bomb the hell out of them.
Yeah, yeah.
But if Egypt shoot activists,
it's just the third story on
BBC. Yeah.
Yeah. It's what we've got to do. A necessary evil. As Tony Blair said, you're damned if you do and you're damned if you don't.
I just watched the news story this morning.
He doesn't give a damn and just gets on with it.
I just watched the news story this morning. It was a whole, you know, 6-7 minutes video on BBC. And I watched it all the way through. And at the end, you know, 180 have been executed in January. Not all get jail sentences.
No.
They just shoot. That's all right, apparently. That ISIS beheads a journalist. War.
Can't be having that.
No, can't be having that. We're stupid, aren't we?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
The children of the world.
Mm.
We shout at mummy and daddy for doing things that we're not happy with.
It's back to being controlled again, isn't it? And we know that religion is a big controller. And,
but the new religion's TV.
Yeah,
TV is only one lifetime old. Remember, What did we do before television?
Mm-hmm.
What did we do with it? They tell you what to see and they tell you what it means. So in the past tense that we always live, it's cement, and that's how it's held together, isn't it?
It is. Yeah.
This is how the shepherds do it now. The shepherds should be called the builders.
Mm-hmm.
They should be called the builders because this never ends, does it? Never bloody ends. A non-stop coax of information where we watch intently.
Yeah.
We cannot, because we're so well programmed, understand how they do it to us. They say stuff like, when the going gets tough, the tough get colouring in the Telegraph this week. In the Telegraph this week. For the stressed out executives, colouring books are proven to be the answer. What a load of trollop that is. But in the department of what can we get them to believe today, what shit shall we tell them that they might actually believe?
Yeah.
In that department, that day, at that time, they say, let's put out this story. Stressed executives enjoy colouring books. And let's see how many say, oh, that seems a good idea, doesn't it? Even Sheridan says it's a good idea. Even our guru Thomas Sheridan said, that'll be a good idea, I'm all for this. Jesus Christ, do people know nothing? Next, a hectic morning of Dot to Dot. And after lunchtime, baking buns with mummy. Jesus Christ almighty. We've already got cooking programmes teaching you how to make buns and cakes. I mean, we've had them for years.
That, what came to mind then was little Stewie out of Family Guy. He's the little baby psychopath, isn't he?
Yeah.
Plotting things while he's colouring in.
Honest to God. Oh. If you want to colour in at 35, 45, you colour to your heart's content, my friend. Because that's what the world is now.
Yeah,
it is. We're gone. We're totally gone from what things used to be like. I can't really remember.
No.
But if you saw a 40-year-old colouring in, what would you think?
Well,
what the flick are you doing?
I think I've said it before. My granddad ended up on the building site at 11 year old because they couldn't afford to send him to school. So straight into the building site, and he remembers coming home and crying to his mum to say, send me back to school. He said, I can't do this work. I can't do it. It was physical work at 11 years old on a building site. And I'm talking back then, that was the late 20s. So everything was done by hand. The hammering, the chiseling, the lifting, the carrying, the shoveling. it was
hard work for them.
Hard work. And he at 11 years old, he didn't come home and colour in. He came home, had something to eat, and were knackered, went to bed, tired out. Hands sore.
You could actually make a case, couldn't you, that in the last 100 years, our lives have improved tremendously. They really have.
Yes.
We live in what we call luxury, royal luxury now,
mm-hmm.
Compared to 100 years ago.
Mm. I was talking to one of my customers today, and some of the places in North Yorkshire didn't get inside toilets until the mid-80s.
Well, I know from... I'm stuck to the mass of my head. 75, 76 was when we got an inside loo.
Mm-hmm.
So it's, but we're living like royalty, really.
Yes.
I mean, the powers that be are piping everything into our house.
They are,
including,
yeah.
You know, the Pied Piper lies and web and net of deceit.
It all comes by pipes.
Yeah, we've been piped. The Pied Piper is doing his job really well. We're getting lazier and weaker. And as history tells us time and time again, Plato told us, the language is now falling to pieces, isn't it?
Mm.
The language is now falling apart. It's become, it's just, it's a farce, it's silliness. People make words up, abbreviate words, and everybody's talking about the surface. Everyone's talking about what they've seen. But that scene is usually spelt S-C-E-N-E, which is not what you've seen, it's what you've been shown.
Yeah.
And what you've been shown is how you've been made. If anybody who's trying to work out how this works, just listen back, because that's all we talk about, isn't it?
Yeah.
How this actually works. When you first discover the chaos that is reality, you say to yourself, I've heard the word compartmentalisation. I've heard the word...
sustainability.
Whatever. I've heard all these little these little phrases and ideologies, which are just ideas, by the way. Ideology is just a long way of saying an idea. But, and isms, you know, fascism, corporatism, communism.
Multiculturalism.
These isms, yeah. I'm completely confused. And Marxism, I'm trying to work out which is bloody which and what does that apply. I'm having so, forget it, it doesn't matter. The world is a mirror of the life that you live, the relationships you have, and the problems you encounter. The world is doing exactly the same thing on a bigger scale, because they have more power and influence. That's all.
Mm.
It's all power and influence, nothing else. What can they get you to do?
Mm.
That's all that matters. They will pay what they have to pay to get you to do it.
Yeah, as it in that little clip, the meaning of life. It was the little board meeting, wasn't it?
Yep.
And as I was listening there, I wrote down, we speak it into reality. They have the little board meeting. And they right, what have you been doing? What have you been and that's what's going on in little pockets all over, in little bits and in times.
Look at the European jam jar thing. You can't wash jam jars and make your own jam.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, that's rubbish. You can't sell cakes at your local village fete. Rubbish.
Mm.
Right. But these are all stories to annoy us, to get us to talk about that today. Yeah. It doesn't mean it's reality. But if we speak it into reality, it starts to become reality.
It does.
That is the key that we never understand. The new stories are designed for us to share.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't mean they are true.
No, they're on air.
Exactly.
The Air Force. You've said this before. It's the Air Force. You're speaking it out in wind, out of your windpipe.
It doesn't matter whether it's true or not.
No.
It's whether you think it's true or not.
Mm, yeah.
Now, the chances are you can do nothing about it. It's about people you don't know, you do not have contact with, you will never have contact with.
Nope.
And your opinion is of no bloody interest to them, because you're not going to do anything about it. If you really were interested, then you would, regardless of who you voted for, you would make your local representative, because he represents what you want him to say, you would make him do his job, but you don't. You sit at home and bitch and moan like a pathetic Mary Whitehouse.
Mm-hmm.
and no one's flicking listening. Because no one gives a flying shit what you think.
No.
So you find the playground is a place for you to actually air your views.
Mm-hmm.
Called Facebook. Bullshit. I can smell it from here. You stupid little people. But still you do it. Still you do it. Thinking signing this and doing that. Mm. Saying this and joining that.
Joining groups.
It's going to make a difference.
Mm.
You are guilty. And absolutely as guilty as everybody else that you think you're better than of playing pretend.
Mm.
You are playing a game of pretend. You're pretending to make the world a better place while sat on your ass and doing nothing of the sort. You bitch and moan and complain and whine about what everybody else is doing. And the chances are, no one even knows your name. The chances are, you haven't even put your own name online. The chances are, it's a pretend bloody name that you're using.
Let's play pretend.
So, how big do you want this game of pretending to be? Because it is absolutely bloody ridiculous.
It's all illusion, you know. I'm not going to use my real name, though.
You would be at the local council meeting, airing your views and challenging the decisions and trying to affect the place you live, the community that you represent, and making the world a little bit better. But you're not, are you? No, you're not. No, no, no. You're a poisonous gossip, spreading the news, telling people what to do. And somehow, you can't work out why nobody likes you. You call other people stupid? Buy a mirror. And buy a bloody big one. Because you're going to have to see all of you to understand what I've just said.
So much of the news this year has been hopeless, depressing, and above all, confusing. To which the only response is, oh dear. But what this film is going to suggest is that that defeatist response has become a central part of a new system of political control. And to understand how this is happening, you have to look to Russia. And to a man called Vladislav Surkov, who is a hero of our time. Surkov is one of President Putin's advisors and has helped him maintain his power for 15 years. But he has done it in a very new way.
Vladimir Vladimirovich Putin.
He came originally from the avant-garde art world. And those who have studied his career say that what Surkov has done is import ideas from conceptual art into the very heart of politics. His aim is to undermine people's perception of the world, so they never know what is really happening. Surkov turned Russian politics into a bewildering, constantly changing piece of theatre. He sponsored all kinds of groups, from neo-Nazi skinheads to liberal human rights groups. He even backed parties that were opposed to President Putin. But the key thing was that Surkov then let it be known that this was what he was doing, which meant that no one was sure what was real or fake. As one journalist put it, it's a strategy of power that keeps any opposition constantly confused, a ceaseless shape-shifting that is unstoppable because it's indefinable.
Isn't that what's going on?
Mm. Yeah.
We try and make sense of the confusion and chaos that is being created,
yeah,
on purpose.
Mm-hmm.
Take a step back and you'll find that everybody else is playing.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody else is playing. The whole world is winging it, pretending that they know what's going on.
Yeah.
Because it makes them feel less than if they don't. People will admit they don't know. The war that is taking place is the war that's taking place forever. It's for our minds. It's for who we are going to be. Now, it wouldn't be difficult for me to say, do you think the agenda is to turn boys into girls and girls into boys? Because that's what I see. And we only ever talk about what we see, what we hear, and how it fits into what we understand.
Yeah.
We don't really worry about what everybody else is doing so much, do we?
No. Nope.
We just, what we see and what we hear.
Mm-hmm.
And the esoteric side of things tells us that This really is a very old control system with the sun and the sea and the stars. And I'm not going to say that I disagree with that. I actually totally do agree with that. This is a very old control system that is clearly shown to us in the Bible for those that would like to decode it. It is a following the stars type system.
Mm-hmm.
And dropping presents off at Christmas, which is a new addition because that's not in the Bible at all, is it? So this buying things at Christmas is a little new. But it tells us how to be good people because it knows that we can't be.
Mm-hmm.
Because it creates the very reality that makes us fight for survival. The survival that we fight for is what they claim that they need to create to make us creative. If we didn't have to actually be who we are and create to survive, then the world wouldn't move forwards. If they made life too easy for us, then we wouldn't have to invent anything. So it is that desire to build and improve that has been bred into us all. Ideally, that's the idea. That's what is the reason why they do this. And are they wrong? Because we do get satisfaction out of creating things, improving things, making things better.
Yeah.
You and I speak that when our days are done, will we have added something to the world that has helped? Well, that's why we sit and do this, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Have we helped a few people along the way?
Yeah.
So, regardless of whether it's programming or not, we're doing it, aren't we?
Yeah.
You build things.
Yeah.
That will be left behind a long time after you are.
Mm-hmm.
You build, you fix, you repair.
Mm-hmm.
And although I don't build, fix, or repair, I do provide a service. But in my own way, doing what I'm doing, I'm trying to join the club of build, fix, and repair.
Yeah.
Because if you're listening to us on YouTube now, then you're part of the reason we do this.
Yeah.
It's selfish in a way that we do it for ourselves, to listen back and see if we've learned something. Because only by speaking it into reality does it become something that we've said.
Yeah.
You know, that many people say, oh, I said that, or I wish I'd said that, or I was thinking that years ago. No. We actually use this time on a Tuesday to chart our journey, don't we?
Mm.
This is our journey, our chart, and where we are right now.
Yeah.
And we're 7 or 8 years in. Well, if you listen to us and you're not 7 or 8 years in, then good for you. We got caught for many hours listening to myths and legends, historical dates that may or may not be true, fights and wars and fallouts, and ways of thinking that we thought we had to learn. And yet, the four things you need is to understand the money system, understand what religion is for, understand history is what the winners say it is, and cannot possibly be true in entirety, and politics, which is the mirror of the life you live. They really do represent you. And the reason that they get away with representing you is because you recognise that that's you. Would you swap places with them? Well, yes, you would. Would you do what they do? You say no, you wouldn't. But then watch something like Yes Minister or Yes Prime Minister. Watch that programme and realise that it is very possible that to please the people you need to please, to maintain the power and increase the power you have, you have to make tricky decisions. Life is easy without people. It's people that make it complicated, and they do it on purpose.
Yeah.
And that happens in your life too.
Mm.
It happens in all our lives.
Yeah.
If we could achieve something in the time that we do this, it is to simplify what is the life you already know is being lived by you and everybody around you.
Mm-hmm.
The only thing different between you and people above you is your education level and the money situation you're in. It could be you and they could be them. It doesn't matter. That's all it is. It's the same game.
Mm-hmm.
Control, power, influence and popularity. Well, they're doing the same thing. Is it evil? It depends where you sat on the depends where you sat on the stairs here, doesn't it?
Mm, it does.
There's 13 stairs to the top, isn't there?
There is.
And, it depends where you are on the stairs. If you're at the bottom of the stairs, this bloody thing's evil. If you're at the top of the stairs, it's a necessary evil. It's the way that we push humanity forwards. The bottom of the stairs wants to stay where they are and resist change. The top of the stairs is all about change. It's all about what's new. It's all about what's next.
Mm-hmm.
So you're living in the past, the present, or the future. We're about halfway up the stairs, Mooney, aren't we?
I'd like to
live
think
in the
so
present.
I'd like
we
to
live
think
in the present.
Bottom
yeah.
step anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I would say we're halfway up the stairs.
Mm-hmm.
As Paul McCartney's Frog Dance says, halfway up the stairs is pretty much the best place to be.
And the system does, we do create things, we do try and make things better. And the evil side of it buries those things, doesn't it? Because...
Well, it buys them off us.
It buys, it does.
It then reincarnates them in a way that is useful to them, and then they sell it back to us.
Yes, yeah. In
you know
when
that
the time's right, they sell it back to us. Yeah.
The computers we're using are redundant in the real world. In the real world of the future.
Mm-hmm.
Google. Let's have a look at Google.
Mm.
Okay, can search the entire internet in less than 1 second and answer your query.
Mm-hmm.
Think about the computing power that is required to do that. Then have a look around your house and see how much of a fraction of that you have.
Mm.
It's ridiculous.
Yeah.
In today's modern laptop, we have, what is it, 10,000 times more computing power than the first rocket to the moon had?
Mm.
Computing power is doubling about every 18 months. And who knows where computers are going to actually take us? Are they going to become living conscious beings? Well, we've been terrified that they're going to be. And you have to say that, yeah, with the personal assistance that we've been offered,
mm-hmm. yeah.
you can ask your phone or your computer anything, and it will actually reply to you.
Yeah.
With the correct answer.
Mm-hmm.
You have to say this is one hell of a personal assistant, isn't it?
Yeah, it is, yeah.
I mean, this is what I need. You'll finally be able to say to this personal assistant, check my emails, and they'll check it. Reply to my emails, and you'll speak it, and they'll actually do it for you.
Yeah.
Pay this, pay that, and what's this, and what's that, and who's where, and how much is... The internet is the great leveller. It's going to level everything that we call business opportunity. And by that I mean that we're going to be able to have access to the cheapest. So whatever you need from the internet, you will be able to find the cheapest online. Which actually eliminates everybody else.
Yeah.
Because you'll buy from the cheapest. And if the cheapest has been subsidized, then they're mm-hmm. going to win. They are going to win. No matter what it is that you have as a business idea, should you need to use the internet for it, you best be the most efficient ever. Because if you aren't, somebody else will take it off you.
Yeah, it's open to the world then to see what you're doing, isn't
exactly.
it?
Exactly. Yeah. Whereas before, locally, you could be quite a talent.
Yes.
But there is no local.
Not anymore.
There is no local now.
No.
So the internet is great because we want everything for free, don't we?
Mm-hmm.
We actually want to use it for free. We're prepared to pay the fee every month to get on,
mm-hmm.
but after that, we don't really want to pay for things that we find entertaining. So how do we succeed?
Mm-hmm.
How do we succeed in the new world?
Yeah, yeah.
Well, yeah. In the brave new world that is the internet, I don't think we have much chance, you and I.
No.
We're done.
No.
But you have a skill that the internet doesn't provide.
Yes,
you
at the moment.
Fix, repair and build things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I have a skill the internet can't provide.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So maybe we're both quite fortunate.
Mm-hmm.
because the last show we did, clearly we made the point that 85% of supermarket employees are going to be out of business, out of a job, inside 5 years. And along with the cars you don't need to drive, because they'll drive themselves. I think those two actual statistics mean that the unskilled labourer is no longer required.
Yeah, this is the, as Aldous Huxley said, the technological revolution.
But as technology replaces us at a speed that will only increase, then the economy will fall a little bit further, and the machines don't go shopping. So how are we going to survive? This is the problem, because if the United Kingdom or England as such is going to remain a world force and export whatever it is that it wants to export, then the first world countries are going to have to embrace technology first. And that's Japan, England, the USA, France, Canada. They're going to have to embrace technology first.
Well, we've said before that this is going to eventually think for you. And we know that
it's already doing that.
It's already doing it at the moment. You've experienced, I've experienced it. You talk about things and suddenly it appears up on your adverts on your right-hand side of your screen. And you think, where did that come from? My wife experienced it with my son when he was looking through his for his motorcycle gear. It appeared up on my wife's computer, and she said, "I've not looked at motorcycle information." I says, "No, but he's using the same IP address, so that IP address is registered that we're interested in motorcycle. So they know now that somebody in the family's got a motorcycle." So it's going to bombard you with those adverts. So it already knows everything about you.
The thing about the future is that I know it's a spying machine for governments. I know it's a security services wet dream, really. But the actual monetary side of this is the advertisers.
Exactly.
We don't watch adverts anymore.
No.
Most people have got the ability to record TV and fast forward it. And if you don't choose to do that, you can watch it on iPlayer, Channel 4's player. Channel 5's got one, that sort of thing. An ITV player as well. So you can eliminate the adverts. So for the past 15, 20 years, the advertisers have known that their future is not in the traditional methods. All the repeating TV stations, I've said this before, will collapse. Eventually they'll collapse.
Yeah.
Because no one's going to watch them.
No.
Because you can watch what you want, when you want.
Yes. At a time without when a time you want table. It, yeah.
Yeah, so those programs are gone, are done. So the internet will take over TV as we know it. The main channels will still be there, but the content will be our choice.
Yeah.
They will provide, you know, brand new content and we'll all watch it at the same time. But the majority of the time, we'll be watching what we want. So the advertisers are going to have to work very hard to get into our lives. And even though you say, yeah, it's governments around the world that are placing microphones and this, that, and the other in all the things that we use, the tech that we use, the truth is that behind the governments are the advertisers who are paying for this privilege, and paying governments for the privilege of being able to get this information. Because without that ability to sell you what they want to sell you when you want to buy it after you've been convinced you need to buy it, they cannot be in business.
No, and
big business cannot exist. In other words, government is the facilitator.
The government is the facilitator, as Jack Straw said. I've got many contacts on speed dial on my phone.
But the government is the facilitator in saying, yes, we'll allow you to do this. The mafia gets a cut by saying, yeah, we'll let you. So it's, okay, the spy agencies are doing it as well, but the government already engineered that. So they have the information. To give it to the advertisers have to pay. Now, we always thought the advertisers were paying the government, we always thought the government were buying the information from the advertisers, but that's changed around. they've managed to turn that around now. Mm-hmm. Now the government takes charge and the advertisers pay for it. Mm-hmm. And the information they give to the advertisers decides who wins and loses.
Yeah.
In other words, the internet is going to be controlled by the information that's released to the companies that are prepared to pay the most for it.
Exactly. Yeah.
The rest of the time, we'll all be scrabbling about radio stations, TV. We'll all be doing our own radio stations, TV stations, music stations, selling things, exchanging things. We'll all be doing that on the internet. But there'll be no money in it. There'll be no profit in it.
No.
Because we don't want to make a profit for other people. Because we want to keep that little profit for ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
So it'll all engineer that it'll be a swap shop.
Yeah.
It will be swap shop in the way that we'll be swapping credits and swapping whatever it is.
Yeah. And we through the things that we experience and we talk about, we know, we were talking about this the other day, about income tax. Income tax will be a thing of the past.
It will eventually
We won't pay income tax. And
well, because not enough people will be working.
Exactly.
So they'll have to raise it another way.
They'll have to raise it in other ways, yes.
So they'll reduce income tax and raise sales tax. It's got to be that way.
And little bits of information that you get. My brother-in-law works in a tax office.
Well, exactly, because you can't tax benefits.
And he's...
You can't tax benefits.
No, you can't.
But you can tax benefits if you put it on sales tax. Put it on what they buy.
What they're buying, yeah.
So that's got to be the way forward,
and that fits with the token card.
Yeah, yeah.
When your benefits will go on, and they're going to stop calling them benefits, aren't they? It's called universal credit. Yeah. And that tells you that you're borrowing it. You're going to pay that back sometime.
Yeah. Well, they're going to raise benefits by 5 and 10%. They're going to have to.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, because loads of people, but the sales tax will take it away.
Yeah. And I was chatting to my brother-in-law, and there's nobody in their tax office under 30. They are not taking on new recruits.
In the next 20 years, they won't be needed.
Yeah, they won't be needed.
Now, I made a mistake, actually. About 6-7 weeks ago, I said, I reckon that the tax receipts this time around for HMRC will be lower, and they'll be panicking about we need to make up this
the shortfall.
It's election year. Stupid me. 12.8 billion pounds in taxes were paid, a record since records began. Records began in about 1950, but that's not when they said, since records began in 1997 or something like that. Since records began well before 1950s, actually. Anyway, so it seems I'm wrong there. Okay, so record tax receipts by HMRC.
Mm-hmm.
Good for them.
Yeah.
You recommending that way? No, no. These carbon credits are coming. Slowly though. Australia is currently kicking back against carbon credits. So, time to just slow down a little bit.
Yeah.
Slow down a bit. On Mock the Week, I watched Mock the Week, which actually meant Mock the Week.
The Week, yeah.
Well, who's the weak? Is it us or is it them?
Yeah.
Do we mock them or do they mock us? Would you say it was about 50-50?
I would have said yes, it's just two-way street, is that?
I would say so. But anyway, Mock the Week, they had a news question and they had to guess. The answer was 95%. Got my attention. The answer was, actually, after all the jokes they gave, the answer was 95% of scientists now agree that global warming is caused by human beings. It's caused by us.
Yeah.
So they're getting there. Well, slowly but surely. I mean, that 1967 Iron Mountain report.
Yes.
Right? Which some people say, that's being debunked. That is not real. That is not. Okay, I don't care whatever you say about it. But the one thing we do know is it was published.
And it was
published. In 1960 bloody seven.
Yeah.
So read the thing and then tell me it's rubbish. And then I'll click you off my friends list. Okay? Because it doesn't matter if it's real or being debunked or however you want to tell me your opinion is. Read it and tell me it's wrong. It's a bit like Alex Jones. Now, Alex Jones, I have no opinion on Alex Jones that matters to anybody. It's a news service. And it's a pretty good news service. Up to date, every day, free of charge. Can't ask for more. As for Alex Jones, I have no idea who he is. But the news service is pretty good. Up to date, free every day. Does anybody say thanks for the free news service? No. Those people want to pick on Alex Jones. Well, I don't mind. I laugh at those people and feel sorry for them, because they are super stupid. It doesn't bloody matter.
No.
You see, if they were actually real about this, then they would pick on the BBC newscaster.
Mm-hmm.
They would pick on the ITV newscaster. Mm. They would pick on the Sky newscaster. They would look into their backgrounds, and they would debunk them as well.
Mm-hmm.
But they don't, do they? They debunk Alex Jones. And do you know why? Because they're bloody jealous of him. For me, it doesn't matter. Let's change directions. Let's go with something that we actually made a note of about a month or two ago.
Yeah, yeah.
And we
decided, did.
We talk about everything we want to.
This was after a show, wasn't
but
it?
But we always make notes after the show.
We do a better show after we've done
we
the
show.
We
do a better show before and after. After, yeah. But for the first time, we've actually said we made some notes about Capricorn.
We did, yeah.
Because we know we're following the stars.
Mm-hmm.
And there is 12 houses that we're meant to be following, and the story of our lives does actually go with the 12 houses. Following the stars is something we've been doing for a long time. Most people, but some people read them every day.
Mm-hmm. I used to do.
Some people actually believe
to
that
see if
those
got it right.
those star signs are actually appropriate, accurate, and really do mean something.
Mm.
And you know what? I'm not going to say that they don't. I'm not going to do that, because my character, as a Scorpio, is pretty much well written in the books. So, and I read the characters of other star signs, and they're not actually as appropriate as mine.
No.
So I'm not sure if I'm actually being who they say I should be, or being who somebody else says I should be.
Yes. I know what you mean.
The thing is that we don't know who God is, but the guy wearing white with the beard, sat in the clouds, seems a little childish. I've always said, just put another O in there, you get the word good, and it still fits in every bloody sentence that God can appear in. So I think perhaps the stage name is God and the real world is good. Hard work doing the right thing, isn't it?
Yes.
It is actually hard work being good.
Yeah.
Capricorn is December the 21st. The star sign that starts December the 21st. They're usually jolly good-looking people, Capricorns, with good teeth, if not teeth that are perhaps bigger than some star signs.
All right.
They are. But they're good-looking people, and quite fussy. Quite fussy and quite particular.
Mm-hmm.
Capricorns are, more often than not, very attractive.
Right. That rules me out, then.
Well, when you told me you're a Capricorn, I thought, you can't be.
I'm actually the one before it, Anna. What's before it?
God knows, your birth is in Capricorn.
Yes, our birth sign's Capricorn, but me...
You're a good-looking fellow. So they say. In Halifax or Huddersfield.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's a seahorse, isn't it? Seahorse or seagoat?
Seagoat, yeah.
Yeah, and that's...
Half fish, half goat.
In the story of life, that is the seaman, isn't it?
Yes.
That's the one that's the male that swims through the sea and can be male or female, because that actual seahorse can be male or female.
Seahorse can be male or female, yeah.
So that is the story, the historic story of our lives, that's the seaman.
Mm-hmm.
That's the seahorse or the seaman.
Yeah.
When you see pictures of the horses swimming, running through the sea, or the horses sort of flying in the sky, you realise that's Capricorn.
Mm-hmm.
That is actually symbolising Capricorn.
Yeah.
And the road as well. The road to, because it's climbing up the hill, isn't it?
The
seaman is climbing up the hill.
Yeah. Get to the top of the mountain.
It is the the number one seaman.
Yeah.
That breaks into the hull.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The wonderful world of water. But no one believes us anymore.
No
one believes us. Years ago we talked about this.
We're encapsulated in it from birth.
Yeah, I mean the fact
from conception.
Yeah, but
sorry.
The fact that our language confirms it time and time again, nobody listens, nobody believes us.
No.
And even if they do understand it, they don't understand it to the depth because they don't fathom how important this is. No. They can't do it. They peer into it.
Yes.
Okay, they peer into it, but the peer is full of amusement arcades.
I'm going to say they're distracted by the sideshow.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So the peer doesn't appear like a peer.
No.
It appears like a circus.
Mm-hmm.
And a circus is a circle.
Mm-hmm.
And it circles us.
Yeah.
Round and round and round.
Yeah.
And still, we don't get it.
Back to the nucleus that you were.
We know we've been programmed.
Yeah.
But we don't know how we've been programmed. We think we've been programmed by television. This isn't true. We've been programmed by basic language.
Mm-hmm.
This is the language of the basic, or sick bay.
Sick bay,
because
we
live in wards. We are wards.
Mm-hmm.
But we have no patience. We're called patients because we live in wards, but we have no patience. We want it all, and we want it now.
Now we
like
are.
Spoiled little children, because we are spoiled little children.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't get it. We look up to the skies, but we never see anything that matters. Because we think we have to see something that's invisible.
Yes,
it's not invisible.
No.
The deities, the demons, and all the things that the church tells us, the superstition, the supernatural, and just be scared of the dark.
Mm.
It's worked a bloody treat, hasn't it?
It has, yeah. I was just thinking of the word fellows and followers, very similar. And all religions have followers, don't they? And we were talking earlier about your friends. You follow friends on Facebook. Do you follow your friends on Facebook?
If they're stars, you always follow stars.
Follow stars, yeah. You follow
your stars.
Yes. And what we were talking about earlier was once you've lost those friends and you've stopped following.
So they've been your fry end.
Yes.
You've ended your friendship.
You've ended your friendship.
You see,
yeah.
Because small fish are called
fry.
Fry, exactly.
Mm-hmm. And then you become, you take the transition then to a leader. You stop following the herd and you tread your own path and you walk your own way by yourself because it's a personal journey. You cannot, we've done it a little bit together, but only on once a week.
2 hours a week, wasn't it?
Yeah.
After we found each other.
Yes.
You've been doing a year, I've been doing a similar amount of time. This was 2007 time, wasn't it?
It was, yeah.
We'd both started. Mm-hmm. 2008. But it is. This journey can it'll only be done alone.
Mm-hmm.
I have another person who I'm helping with the journey. But this person thinks I'm going to help them more than I'm going to.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to push them away.
Yeah.
You have to physically push them away and say, look, you've sort of got to have something to share. Otherwise, I'm not interested. It's a bit Dragon's Den, isn't it?
Mm.
Where you say, look, I've achieved what I've achieved. And I'm trying to show you that you can do that too. But don't keep asking me to do it for you. The news, the gossip, the chaos, the confusion, it's all designed to ruin, spoil, and stop your journey.
Yeah.
We started this show with the clip from the beginning of life. And you know what it is? It's you discovering you. It's you telling you the truth.
Yes.
And it's you fixing you, because you're the one that's broken. Nothing else.
No.
The world isn't broken.
No.
The world is full of broken people. You have to understand that you have the opportunity to fix yourself. Teach your children, and if you can teach them well, they have an opportunity to be more than you were. That's how this actually works. There is no other way. There is the idea there's another way, and there is a conversation that says there's another way, but there is no other way. Our entire lives we have had to deal with a shit education.
We have.
They have told us nothing that we really need to know,
and
except how to work for them.
And it's crap because it's free. And Rupert Murdoch's horrible things that they say, but there's some truth in it. And you said about the NHS, about it, what can you expect? It's a bargain basement health service. You get in the very basics. And the same with the education, unless you've been to Eton or Harrow or all these. And people have to pay a lot of money to send the children there.
It's awful to accept.
It is awful to accept.
We are the bottom of the bloody
we
heap.
We are the bottom of the heap.
And we have to work it and fix our bloody selves.
Mm, yeah.
We have to educate ourselves, improve our lives, improve our children's lives, and teach them the things they need so they can improve on what we have achieved.
And if you've done that by yourself, and you've proved yourself and you've educated yourself to a level of these, some of them are buffoons, or they act like buffoons to get what they want, and you've brought yourself up to that level with not having to pay that kind of money, then congratulate yourself, because that's proved that you've stopped being a follower and you've started to be a leader. You're leading yourself. You don't want to be leading everybody else. All they're going to do is drag you down. You need to plough your own furrow.
And then you need to be a teacher.
Yes.
The rest of the world, what the rest of the world is doing doesn't matter.
No, it doesn't.
Watch the news, and it's a con science. Mm. It's a proper con science.
Yes.
You feel guilty for something you did not have any part in making happen.
It's a gilt-edged sword.
Con science. Yeah.
Mm. It is.
The wonderful world of wonder. That's what we should be living in. And the wonder is, what can I make of myself?
Mm.
I wonder what I'm going to be, and I wonder how I'm going to do it. And then you get on and start.
Mm. Yeah.
What everybody else is doing or saying doesn't matter. What everybody else is thinking doesn't matter. What everybody else has, it doesn't matter. Because the only person you have to deal with and sleep with is you.
Mm-hmm.
And you take your time. Because on this internet is everything you need to make a start in discovering who you really are. Not who your dog thinks you are. There's a lot of help on here.
Mm.
There's a lot of distraction.
There is.
There's a lot of people asking for recognition and reward. They want to sell you DVDs and books and things that will help your journey. Some will, some won't. For the past 3 years, I've been reading an awful lot of books. I've been reading the books that I was told to read. And then I was reading the books that I thought I should read. And I never actually realised until just recently, the book I'm going to read is the one I'm going to write.
Yeah.
Because reading other people's books was good.
Mm.
But it wasn't me.
No.
And I kept reading them, and there wasn't things in there that I wanted. And why I asked them to supply what I wanted was silly.
Mm.
I don't know why I thought they would.
No. Who said that, saying there's a book in everybody?
Yeah, there maybe is.
Mm. Yeah.
And maybe it's just a one-night booking.
Mm, the one-night booking, yeah.
Maybe, yeah.
For
maybe
one night
is.
Only.
Yeah, maybe it is.
I hope I don't miss mine.
And I'm okay. But I'm going to write it. I'll write it, and I'll never publish it.
No.
But I'll leave it for my little girl.
Mm, yeah.
And what she does with it, I don't know. But I've got this little feeling inside me that it'll be worth writing.
Yeah.
For me.
Mm.
Because it's all selfish.
It is.
Sell fish.
Fish. Yeah.
Yeah. Because we're the fish. We are the fish.
As if you watch the film, Monty Python.
I know, right at the end.
Right at the end.
Right. And what was the make of toys that we used to play with when we were little? How much a fish? Fisher Price.
Fisher Price, yeah.
Fisher Price.
Mm-hmm.
You see, in that book called The Bible, which is a two-level war, he wasn't a fisherman, was he? He was a fisher
of men.
A leader.
Yeah.
A teacher. He didn't need a stage. He didn't need a church.
No.
The John Wayne of his day. I'm not religious.
No. No.
But I do know what I believe in.
Mm. Yeah. Yeah.
But I'm not religious.
No.
For another Tuesday.
Yeah, it's good night from me.
How much don't we know?
Oh, loads.
More than I ever realised.
Yeah. Thanks for listening.
Whenever life gets you down, Mrs. Brown, and things seem hard or tough, and people are stupid, obnoxious or daft, and you feel that you've had quite enough, just remember that you're standing on a planet that's evolving and revolving at 900 miles an hour. That's orbiting at 19 miles a second, so it's reckoned, a sun that is the source of all our power. The sun and you and me and all the stars that we can see are moving at a million miles a day. In an outer spiral arm at 40,000 miles an hour of the galaxy we call the Milky Way. Our galaxy itself contains 100 billion stars. It's 100,000 light years side to side. It bulges in the middle, 16,000 light years thick, but out by us it's just 3,000 light years wide. We're 30,000 light years from galactic central point. We go round every 200 million years. And our galaxy is only one of millions of billions in this amazing and expanding universe. Keeps on expanding and expanding in all of the directions it can whiz. As fast as it can go, at the speed of light, you know, 12 million miles a minute, and that's the fastest speed there is. So remember when you're feeling very small and insecure, how amazingly unlikely is your birth. And pray that there's intelligent life somewhere up in space, 'cause there's bugger all down here on Earth.